as Oxford University's first ever professor for the public understanding of science, he's become a powerful agent of social change through his discoveries, his lectures, and his books. He's promoted science education and science-based policies through his foundation, through his daily tweets, and even last week on The Daily Show. So neighbors, if you feel as fortunate as I do tonight, please join me in giving a warm Kepler's welcome to our visiting biologist, author, teacher, social activist, tweeter, and Elvis impersonator, Professor Clinton Richard Dawkins.
You've kind of done my job for me. I planned to do some readings from the book. There's a little bit left for me to do. I will read some extracts, and then I will take questions. Since you just mentioned my kindly housemaster, Mr. Ling, I thought I would read a little paragraph about him. Mr. Ling was, in his way, a decent man. A contemporary and friend of mine in the same house recently told me the following nice story. He was illicitly up in a dormitory during the day, kissing one of the housemaids. The pair panicked when they heard a heavy tread on the stairs, and my friend hastily bundled the young woman up onto a windowsill and drew the curtains to hide her standing shape. Mr. Ling came into the room and must have noticed that only one of the three windows had the curtains drawn. Even worse, my friend noticed, to his horror, that the girl's feet were clearly visible, protruding under the curtain. He firmly believed that Mr. Ling must have realized what was going on, but pretended not to, perhaps on boys will be boys grounds. What are you doing up in the dormitory at this hour? Just came up to change my socks, sir. Oh, well, hurry on down. Good call on Mr. Ling's part. That boy went on to become probably the most successful of his generation from the school, the knighted chief executive of one of the largest international corporations in the world, and a generous benefactor of the school, endowing, among other things, the Peter Ling Fellowship. The book doesn't identify the boy, but he is in fact Sir Howard Stringer, as recently CEO of the Sony Corporation in Japan, the only non-Japanese to hold that. This microphone is very sensitive, isn't it? It's a bit of Viagra, I think. So, I'll go back to the beginning of the book now. Glad to know you, Clint. The friendly passport controller was not to know that British people were sometimes given a family name first, followed by the name their parents wanted them to use. I was always to be Richard, just as my father was always John. Our first name of Clinton was something we forgot about, as our parents had intended. To me, it has been no more than a niggling irritation, which I would have been happier without, notwithstanding the serendipitous realization that it gives me the same initials as Charles Robert Darwin. But alas, nobody anticipated the United States Department of Homeland Security. Not content with scanning our shoes and rationing our toothpaste, they decreed that anyone entering America must travel under his first name, exactly as written in his passport. So I had to forego my lifelong identity as Richard and rebrand myself Clinton R. Dawkins when booking tickets to the States, and of course, when filling in those important forms, the ones that require you explicitly to deny that you are entering the USA in order to overthrow the Constitution by force of arms. Sole purpose of visit, was the British broadcaster Gilbert Harding's response to that. Nowadays, such levity will see you banged up. Clinton Richard Dawkins, then, is the name on my birth certificate and passport. and my father was Clinton John. As it happened, he was not the only C. Dawkins whose name appeared in the Times as the father of a boy born in the Escatine Nursing Home, Nairobi, in March 1941. The other was the Reverend Cuthbert Dawkins, Anglican missionary and no relation. My bemused mother received a shower of congratulations from bishops and clerics in England, unknown to her, but kindly calling down God's blessings upon her newborn son. We cannot know whether the misdirected benedictions intended for Cuthbert's son had any improving effect on me, but he became a missionary like his father, and I became a biologist like mine. To this day, my mother jokes that I might be the wrong one. I'm happy to say that more than just my physical resemblance to my father reassures me that I'm not a changeling and never destined for the church. Clinton first became a Dawkins family name when my great-great-great-grandfather, Henry Dawkins, 1765-1852, married Augusta, daughter of General Sir Henry Clinton, who, as Commander-in-Chief of British forces from 1778 to 1782, was partly responsible for losing the American War of Independence. The circumstances of the marriage make the commandeering of his name by the Dawkins family seem a bit cheeky. The following extract is from a history of Great Portland Street, where General Clinton lived. In 1788, his daughter eloped from this street in a hackney coach with Mr. Dawkins, who eluded pursuit by posting half a dozen other hackney coaches at the corners of the street leading into Portland Place, with directions to drive off as rapidly as possible, each in a different direction. I wish I could claim this ornament of the family escutcheon as the inspiration for Stephen Leacock's Lord Ronald, who flung himself upon his horse and rode madly off in all directions. I'd also like to think that I inherited some of Henry Dawkins' resourcefulness, not to mention his ardor. This is unlikely, however, as only 1/32nd part of my genome is derived from him. 1/64th part is from General Clinton himself, and I have never shown any military leanings. Tess of the D'Urbervilles and the Hound of the Baskervilles are not the only works of fiction that invoke hereditary throwbacks to distant ancestors, forgetting that the proportion of genes shared is halved with every generation, and therefore dies away exponentially, or it would if it were not for cousin marriage, which becomes ever more frequent, more distant the cousinship, so that we are all more or less distant cousins of each other. It is a remarkable fact, which you can prove for yourself without leaving your armchair, that if you go back far enough in a time machine, any individual you meet who has any living human descendants at all must be an ancestor of everybody living. When your time machine has traveled sufficiently far into the past, everybody you meet is an ancestor either of everybody alive in 2013 or of nobody. There are no intermediates. By the method of reductio ad absurdum, beloved of mathematicians, you can see that this has to be true of our fishy ancestors of the Devonian era. My fish has to be the same as your fish, because the absurd alternative is that your fish's descendants and my fish's descendants stayed chastely separate from each other for 300 million years, yet are still capable of interbreeding today. The only question is how far back you have to go to apply that argument. Clearly, not as far as our fishy forebears, but how far? Well, hurdling swiftly over the detailed calculations, I can tell you that if the Queen is descended from William the Conqueror, you probably are too. And give or take the odd illegitimacy, I know I am, as with almost everybody with a recorded pedigree. Now we come to the bit that I've been upstaged by David. But I'm going to read it anyway. Henry and Augusta's son, Clinton George Augustus Dawkins, 1808-71, was one of the few Dawkinses actually to use the name Clinton. If he inherited any of his father's ardor, he nearly lost it in 1849 during an Austrian bombardment of Venice, where he was the British consul. I have a cannonball in my possession, sitting on a plinth, bearing an inscription on a brass plate. I don't know whose is the authorial voice, and I don't know how reliable it is, but for what it's worth, here is my translation from French, then the language of diplomacy. One night, when he was in bed, a cannonball penetrated the bed covers and passed between his legs. It happened to him no more than superficial damage. This narrow escape of my ancestors' vital parts took place before he was to put them to use. And it is tempting to attribute my own existence to a stroke of ballistic luck, as David indeed did. A few inches closer to the fork of Shakespeare's radish and... But actually, my existence and yours and the postman's hangs from a far narrower thread of luck than that. We owe it to the precise timing and placing of everything that ever happened since the universe began. The incident of the cannonball is only a dramatic example of a much more general phenomenon. As I put it before, if the second dinosaur to the left of the tall cycad tree had not happened to sneeze, and thereby failed to catch the tiny shrew-like ancestor of all the mammals, we would none of us be here. We all can regard ourselves as exquisitely improbable. But here, in a triumph of hindsight, we are. CGA Cannonball Dawkins' son, Clinton, later Sir Clinton Edward Dawkins, 1859-1905, was one of many Dawkinses to attend Balliol College, Oxford. He was there at the right time to be immortalized in the Balliol Rhymes, originally published as a broadsheet called The Mask of Balliol in 1881. In the spring term of that year, seven undergraduates composed and printed scurrilous rhymes about personalities of the college. Most famous is the verse that celebrates Balliol's great master, Benjamin Jowett, composed by H.C. Beeching, later Dean of Norwich Cathedral. First come I, my name is Jowett. There's no knowledge, but I know it. I am master of this college. What I don't know isn't knowledge. Less witty but intriguing to me is the rhyme on Clinton Edward Dawkins. Positivists ever talk in such an epic style as Dawkins. God is naught and man is all. Spell him with a capital. Freethinkers were much less common in Victorian times, and I wish I'd met great-great-uncle Clinton. And what should we make of that epic style? I'm now going to read from the chapter, I spent 2 years as an assistant professor, maybe junior assistant professor, at Berkeley, near here. I thought it might be interesting to read a little bit about that. The older members of the audience. Berkeley in the late 1960s was politically seething, and the politics of Telegraph Avenue and Haight-Ashbury across the bay in San Francisco were to dominate our 2 years there. That's my first wife and mine. Lyndon Johnson, who might otherwise have been remembered as a great reforming president, was mired in the disaster that was the Vietnam War, inherited from Kennedy. Just about everyone in Berkeley was against the war, and we joined them in marches in San Francisco, in tear gas parades in Berkeley, in demonstrations, classroom disruptions, and sit-ins. I am proud of my part in protesting against American involvement in Vietnam, proud of having worked hard in the anti-war campaign of Senator Eugene McCarthy, less proud of some of the other political movements in which I was involved. The most memorable of these concerned the surreal episode of the People's Park, fictionalized by David Lodge as the People's Garden in his campus novel, Changing Places. The People's Park campaign was an attempt, ultimately successful, as I discovered when I revisited Berkeley on a filming trip recently, to take over for public recreation a piece of waste ground owned by the university and intended for building. With hindsight, it was a trumped-up excuse for radical political activism for its own sake, trumped up by anarchist student leaders cynically manipulating the gentle flower power street people. The radical student leaders and the infamous Governor Ronald Reagan, Ronald Duck, in David Lodge's novel, gleefully played into each other's hands, each mining the situation to enhance their following among their respective constituents, and each probably knowing exactly what they were doing. And I, together with most of the younger faculty of the university, played right into their hands. We demonstrated, sat in, ran from the tear gas, wrote outrage letters to the newspapers. My first letter to the Times was on the subject.
and cheered as the street people stuck flowers down the rifle barrels of the bewildered and rather scared young National Guardsmen. Honesty compels me to admit a frisson of exhilaration, of which I'm now quietly ashamed at having been tear-gassed and very slightly endangered. I try to peer into my own state of mind in my 20s in Berkeley as honestly as I can. I think what I see there is a kind of youthful excitement at the very idea of rebellion, a Wordsworthian bliss was it in that dawn to be alive, but to be young was very heaven. A student called James Rector was shot dead by an Oakland policeman. It was right to protest against that, and with hindsight, that seemed to have justified in our minds our decision to march for the People's Park in the first place. But of course it didn't justify it at all, not in itself. The decision to march for the People's Park required completely separate justification. We, the younger faculty, convened meetings where we tried to bully our colleagues into cancelling their lectures in solidarity with the activists. And I use the word bully advisedly, for I've seen the same thing more recently on the internet in the form of cyberbullying by radical activists powerful enough to act as a kind of thought police, just as I saw the same thing at school when willing accomplices would rally around a playground bully. I remember with particular regret a faculty meeting at Berkeley when a decent older professor was reluctant to cancel his lecture, and we tried to vote to force him to do so. With remorse, I salute his courage and that of an even older professor whose hand was the sole one raised in support of his colleague's right to fulfill what he perceived as his duty to give his scheduled lecture. As with the school equivalents I've already described, I should have stood up against the bullies, but I didn't. I was still young, but not all that young. Should have known better. Mention of radical politics and the street people brings forth a revealing memory, revealing of a sea change in social mores. I was walking along Telegraph Avenue, axis of Berkeley's beads, incense, and marijuana culture. A young man was walking ahead of me, dressed in the insignia of the flower power generation. Every time a young woman passed him, walking in the opposite direction, he would reach out and tweak one of her breasts. Far from slapping him or crying harassment, she would simply walk on by as if nothing had happened. He would proceed to the next one. Today I find this almost impossible to believe, but it is a very secure memory. His demeanor did not appear especially lascivious, and his action was evidently not taken by the young women as the gesture of a male chauvinist pig. It seemed all of a piece with hippiedom, with the laid-back peace and love atmosphere of 60s San Francisco. I'm very glad to say that things have changed. Today's counterparts in age and class of that young man and the young woman he molested, as we should now say, would be among those most strongly outraged at behavior which was then the norm for that age, class, and political persuasion. I had never been to America before, and I did find some things bewildering. At my first meeting of the zoology faculty, everyone spoke almost entirely in numbers. Who's doing 314? No, I'm doing 246. Nowadays, the English-speaking world knows that Exology 101 means, sometimes patronizingly or even derisively, a freshman's introduction to exology. But all that numerology was perplexing to me when I first arrived. And who today doesn't understand the verb to major? But I recall reading an American campus novel and getting a little fed up with the twittering of sophomores and juniors and seniors, when, like a breath of fresh air, an English major came into the room. Aha, I thought. My mind immediately filled with visions of riding breeches and moustaches. A real character at last. I now want to read, finally, a tribute to, I think, my greatest mentor. I was actually doing research at Oxford under the great Nico Tinbergen, who was one of the leaders of the study of animal behavior, won a Nobel Prize later for it. But although I revered Tinbergen, he was not the one that I saw most of. It was his deputy, Michael Cullen, who was my mentor and that of almost everybody else in the Tim Merton group. This is the eulogy that I spoke at his funeral in 2001. He did not publish many papers himself, yet he worked prodigiously hard, both in teaching and research. He was probably the most sought-after tutor in the entire zoology department. The rest of his time, he was always in a hurry and worked a hugely long day, was devoted to research, but seldom his own research. Everybody who knew him had the same story to tell. All the obituaries told it in revealingly similar terms. You would have a problem with your research. You knew exactly where to go for help, and there he would be for you. I see the scene as yesterday. The lunchtime conversation, the wiry, boyish figure in the red sweater, slightly hunched like a spring wound up with intense intellectual energy, sometimes rocking back and forth with concentration. The deeply intelligent eyes, understanding what you meant even before the words came out. The back of the envelope to aid explanation, the occasionally skeptical, quizzical tilt of the eyebrows under the untidy hair. Then he would have to rush off. He always rushed everywhere, perhaps for a tutorial. And he would seize his biscuit tin by its wire handles and disappear. But next morning, the answer to your problem would arrive in Mike's small, distinctive handwriting. 2 pages, often some algebra, diagrams, a key reference to the literature, sometimes an apt verse of his own composition, or a fragment of Latin or classical Greek, always encouragement. We were grateful, but not grateful enough. If we had thought about it, we would have realized he must have been working on that mathematical model of my research all evening. And it isn't only me for whom he does this. Everybody gets the same treatment, and not just his own students. I was officially Nico Tinbergen's student, not Mike's. Mike took me on without payment and without official recognition when my research became more mathematical than Nico could handle. When the time came for me to write my thesis, it was Mike Cullen who read it, criticized it, helped me polish every line, and all this while he was doing the same thing for his own official students. When, we all should have wondered, does he get time for ordinary family life? When does he get time for his own research? No wonder he so seldom published anything. No wonder he never wrote his long-awaited book on animal communication. In truth, he should have been joint author of just about every one of the hundreds of papers that came out of that group during that golden period. In fact, his name appears on virtually none of them, except in the acknowledgement section. The worldly success of scientists is judged for promotion or honors by their published papers. Mike did not rate highly on this index. But if he had consented to add his name to his students' publications as readily as modern supervisors insist on putting their names on papers to which they contribute much less, Mike would have been a conventionally successful scientist, lauded with conventional honors. As it is, he was a brilliantly successful scientist in a far deeper and truer sense. And I think we know which kind of scientist we really admire. Oxford sadly lost him to Australia. Years later, in Melbourne, at a party for me as visiting lecturer, I was standing, probably rather stiffly, with a drink in my hand. Suddenly, a familiar figure shot into the room in a hurry as ever. The rest of us were in suits, but not this familiar figure. The years vanished away. Everything was the same. Though he must have been well into his 60s by then, he seemed still to be in his 30s. The glow of boyish enthusiasm, even the red sweater. Next day, he drove me to the coast to see his beloved penguins, stopping on the way to look at giant Australian earthworms, many feet long. We tired the sun with talking, not, I think, about old times and old friends, and certainly not about ambition, grant-getting, and papers in Nature, but about new science and new ideas. It was a perfect day, the last I saw him. We may know other scientists as intelligent as Mike Cullen, though not many. We may know other scientists who are as generous in support, though vanishingly few. but I declare we have known nobody who had so much to give, combined with so much generosity in giving.